Right, so let's discuss a set of MCQs which have been issued by ICAI. So, which are the MCQs which I'm discussing right now? So, if you go to on the website of ICAI, right, under students, you have the Board of Studies Knowledge Portal, right, in that you have the sample, right, questions for 30-70 assessment, right, on the Board of Studies Knowledge Portal. Right, in that right now I'm taking the ones for the final course, new scheme, in that the advanced auditing and professional ethics, right, the advanced auditing and professional ethics, the second sample questions two, right, so Board of Studies Knowledge Portal, there you come to the samples for the 30-70 assessment, and there in the new course you have the sample questions two. Right, so these are the ones, XYZ printers. Okay, those are the ones which I am going to discuss with you right now. Okay, so if you, yes, you can keep a file of that open with you. Right, so it's just that I'm going to be along with you when you are trying to, yes, think of what could be the correct answers. And as we look into more and more MCQs, we realize that how. Why we know why we have selected a wrong answer, why it was wrong, what went wrong in our concept, or what is the correct thing, right? So it gives you conceptual clarity, and then expecting that a similar question comes in the exam, you know it conceptually, and you develop your skills, right, for writing the MCQs. Okay, right, so let us have a look into, pay attention. Right, XYZ Printers is a medium-sized printing press with turnover of 100 crore for the financial year 15-16. The company buy paper rims for its press from different suppliers. You are the statutory auditors of the company for 15-16, and the management has informed you that the company has bought paper rims from one of the supplier who is related to one of the director of XYZ Printers. What audit evidence do you need to collect for identifying and assessing the risk of material misstatement associated with related party transaction? So basically, they are asking you the risk assessment procedures of SA 550 related parties. Right, so what does it say? Prior approval of the audit committee, shareholders for the transactions with the supplier, obviously because it's a related party transaction. Materiality, significance of the transactions on the company's financial statements, agreement entered into with the supplier, and the internal control for the transactions with the supplier. So rather, it's the entire list of audit procedures, that is A. Right. Only the prior approval of the audit committee, shareholders for the transaction with the supplier is sufficient. Check whether the company has formulated any policy on dealing with related party transaction and the materiality of transaction. As a statutory auditor, you should check the internal controls and the internal audit reports only. Right. So point number D is anyways a filler. Right, check whether the company has formulated any policy on dealing with related party. We can't only check for the policy. Only prior approval of the audit committee shareholders is sufficient. We don't agree with that. Right, so A is the correct answer. So you might be thinking, oh, which is the biggest out of the three, that is the correct answer. Not always true, but for this one, yes. Right, so prior approval of the audit committee shareholder, the materiality significance of the transaction, agreement entered into with the supplier, and the internal control for the transaction. Right, so next they have only slitted the points, so in BCD. Right, coming to question number two. You are the internal auditor of FCD Bank Limited for 17-18, and the bank maintains all the data on the computer. You are instructed by your senior to verify the loan against fixed deposit of the Navi Mumbai branch. As per the scope of the audit, you need to ensure that proper lien has been marked on all the fixed deposit against which loan has been issued. Which of the following procedure you will follow for the same? Right. Ensure that all FD receipts are attached along with the approved loan documents. Okay. Ensure that all FD receipts against which the loan are sanctioned are discharged in the favor of the bank, and check that the lien is marked in the computer software. Discuss the process followed for lien marking with the branch manager. Ensure that all FD receipts against which the loan has been sanctioned are discharged in the favor of the bank. Check that the lien is marked in the computer software, and the fixed deposit should be kept separately with the branch manager. Okay, so now A No, right, are attached with the supporting loan documents, right? Which of the following procedures? So that's not only what we'll check, because we are maintaining all the data on computer. So there has to be a point regarding computer also in the answer. Okay, so right, no point A also, no point C also, right? Discuss the process. You can't only discuss a process for checking loan against FD. Right, now you have point number D. Point number B and D as the options left. Okay, if you apply the logic for the first one, we said that whichever has the maximum number of sentences, that is the answer, right? But here, what does it say? And the fixed deposit should be kept separately with the branch manager. I don't think like you need to keep it separately with the branch manager. You just need to check that the lien is marked in the computer software. So up to B and D, up to this point, it is the same. Right, that's only the additional thing which is not relevant, right? So which is the correct answer? B, right? Which is the correct answer in this case? B is the correct answer, right? Okay, right, Mr. Vijay Kapoor, a chartered accountant, has been appointed as a statutory auditor for XYZ Private Limited for the audit of their financial statements. The company has mentioned in the audit terms that they will not be able to provide internal audit report to Vijay during the course of the audit. Advise whether Mr. Vijay should accept the proposed audit engagement and on what grounds he can accept or refuse the proposal. Right, so they are not providing access to the internal audit report to the statutory auditor. As per SA210, the auditor can refuse to accept the audit assignment engagement as the management is not giving access to the internal audit report which are necessary in determining the internal control. There is no limitation on the scope of the auditor's work, so the auditor would accept the appointment. The auditor can accept the audit engagement if the management gives representation on its responsibility. Right, so one, they are saying it is a limitation on scope, right, can refuse to accept the assignment as they are not giving access to internal audit report. Second, they are saying this is not a limitation on the scope of the work, because what if you are not getting internal audit report? You can check the internal controls on your own. Right, and management should give a representation that yes, internal controls in the organization is the management's responsibility. Right, so which of the following option is correct? Two only. What is two? There is no limitation on the scope of the work. Then B1, what is that? Both one and three. Right, what is 1 and 3? As per SA210, the auditor can refuse to accept the audit engagement as the management is not giving access to the internal audit report. Right, so as an internal audit has been done and still they are not giving access to the internal audit report to the or statutory auditors, it could be considered a limitation on work. And then is 3 is what? The auditor can accept the audit engagement if the management gives representation. Both 2 and 3, there is no limitation on the scope of the work, so the auditor would accept the assignment appointment and the auditor can accept the engagement if management gives representation. And D1, the auditor can accept the engagement if the management gets representation on its responsibility. Right, so A, B, C and D. Right, what is the A point over there? Two only. There is no limitation on the scope of work. We cannot say that upfront. No, there is no limitation on the scope of work. They have not, see, when internal audit has been done and statutory auditor is asking for the copy of internal audit report, if that is not provided, then obviously it will constitute a limitation on scope. So no question of A. Right, then what about 2 and 3? So again, no limitation on scope, so that point cannot come. Right, and only representations cannot be there. Right, so which is the correct answer? B. Right, so which is the correct answer? B. Okay. Right, next one. Yes, I hope you are all paying attention. Best Manufacturers Limited is a manufacturing company and has entered into an agreement in February, right, with Cisco Brothers for buying land in order to set up their new manufacturing unit. As per the agreement, Best Manufacturers were required to pay 20 lakh as signing amount and the balance amount was required to be paid in 3 installments of 25 lakh each in the month of May, July and September. The title deed for the land was to be transferred after the payment of the second installment in July 2017. So in the accounts for 16-17 of Best Manufacturers and payment of signing amount was booked as an expense. Your firm has been appointed as an auditor of the financial statements for Best Manufacturers Limited. There is conflict between the financial reporting framework and the legal requirement. So what will be the duty of your firm in such a case? Right, so 20 lakh, 25 lakh amount is 20 lakh amount has been initially paid, and then 25 lakh each is to be paid in May, July, and September. The title deed is going to be transferred in July. Right, so that is why the 25 lakh which has been paid earlier has been taken as an expense. Right, so what does it say? Incorporate the change in the financial statements as per the legal requirement. As the title deed has not yet been transferred in favor of the company, there is no need to review the payment in terms of accounting standard or any other legal requirement. Take management representation on the same. Discuss the matter with the management and ensure disclosure of the same in the notes to account. In the absence of the same, the auditor may consider issuing a modified opinion. Right, so it's like a capital advance, you know, an advance given for the purchase of a capital asset for buying of a land. Right, so incorporate changes as per legal requirement? No. Title deed is not transferred, so there is no need to review the payment? No. Take management representation, it is not a substitute. Right, so discuss the matter with the management and ensure the disclosure. Right, about the same in the notes, and in the absence of the same, the auditor may consider issuing a modified opinion. Right, the auditor may consider issuing a modified opinion. Next one, question number 5. BSF Limited is a company engaged in the business of trading leather goods. You are the internal auditor of the company for 17-18. In order to review the internal controls of the sales department of the company, you visited the department and noticed the work division as follows. An officer was handling the sales ledger and the cash receipt, so accounting custodial function together. Another official was handling dispatch of goods and issuance of the delivery challan. Right, so again, person having access to the asset is also having access to the books. One more officer was there to handle customer debit accounts, customer debtor accounts, and issue of the receipts. As an internal auditor, do you think there was proper division of work? If not, why? There is proper division of work? I don't think so. The company has not done proper division of work, as the receipts of the cash and should not be handled by the official handling sales manager, correct? Right, so the person handling the receipt should not be handling the sales ledger, and delivery challan should be verified by an authorized personnel other than the officer handling the dispatch of the goods. Right, so both these cases the division of work should be done. Right, so both B and C are correct. Right, so correct answer over here is D. Both B and C are correct. Your firm has been appointed as the statutory auditor. Next question, of GBM Private Limited for 17-18. While verification of company inventory as at 31st March 2018, you found that significant amount of inventories belonging to the company are held by the other parties. However, the company has kept all the records of the inventories maintained by other parties. What is your duty as an auditor in order to ensure that third parties are not such with whom the stock should not be held and the stock as disclosed in the company records actually belongs to them? Right, so what we study in SA 501, audit evidence specific consideration for selected items, existence and condition of inventory lying with the third party. What is the main procedure we talk of over there? Right, the auditor should obtain the confirmation from the third party. If not, then perform the other audit procedures as appropriate. Right, ensure that the total stock, including the stock with the third party, tally with the stock register maintained by the company. Obtain confirmation from the third party with whom the inventories of the company are held and reconcile the same with the stock register. Conduct a physical verification of stock maintained by the third party. Obtain a written confirmation from the departmental head of the company for the inventories maintained at other places as audit evidence. Right, so again, the more appropriate, the priority wise, the first procedure that we would prefer to follow is obtain the confirmation from the third party and then reconcile the same with the stock register. Okay, is it matching what I am telling you as the answer, or you are not getting the time to think? Not getting time to think, pause. And pause the video, you have the option. Think on your own and then go further. Okay, right. Bhishma Limited decided to appoint Mr. Rajveer, Chartered Accountants, as the branch auditor for the auditor of its Lucknow branch accounts for the year 2017-18. The decision to appoint the branch auditor was taken by way of a board resolution in the meeting of the board of directors of the company held in April, subject to the shareholders' approval in the AGM of the company scheduled to be held in June 2017. Meanwhile, right, so Rajiv has chartered accountants have been appointed, decided to appoint Rajiv chartered accountant as the branch auditor. The decision was taken by the board of directors and it was to be approved by the shareholders in the general meeting. Meanwhile, the principal auditor of the company raised an objection that the branch auditor cannot be appointed without his consent, principal auditor's consent. Whether the objection raised by company auditor is valid? I think whatever of company law we have studied in our syllabus, it nowhere mentions that, you know, for the approval of the branch auditor, the company auditor's approval is required. No. Right. And we know one more thing, that branch audit means we are talking about section 143, subsection 8 of the Companies Act. Right. The appointment of the branch auditor in India, outside India. And then the branch auditor has to submit his report to the company auditor. The objection raised by the company auditor is not valid as per section 143(8) of the Companies Act, and the board has the authority to appoint branch auditor but should be approved by shareholders in general meeting. The objection raised by company auditor is valid as it is necessary to consult the principal auditor before appointing the branch auditor. Right? The board of directors has no authority to appoint branch auditor, so the objection raised is valid. The objection raised by the company auditor is not valid as it is compulsory to appoint branch auditor as per section 139. Right? So not as per section 139, and then is the objection valid? In both cases it is not valid. Right? So the correct answer over here is A. Right? I hope you are seeing the video till now. Okay, next one. Prakash and Company Chartered Accountants are the internal auditor of Textbook Private Limited for the year 16-17. You have been instructed by your senior to check the internal controls for the investments done by the company during the year. While verifying the same, you notice that the property documents, share certificates and other investment documents have been kept in a safe custody locker whose keys are kept with an authorized official of the accounts department of the company, and none other than that official has access to the locker. Right? For whatever we have studied in our syllabus, I remember that, you know, whenever any custody of any locker is to be kept, it cannot be with one person. It has to be with two persons. That is out of our general knowledge. Any safe custody of locker, you know, it cannot be only with one, it has to be with two authorized personnel. As an internal auditor, do you consider as material weakness in internal control? If yes, how will you report the matter? It cannot be considered as a material weakness as the company might not have any other reliable employee. The safe custody locker should always be under the control of two authorized officials. Therefore, the auditor should communicate such material weakness to the management or audit committee. It is not a material weakness to be reported, as giving keys to two or more persons can lead to a situation of confusion only. The auditor should discuss the observation with the management, and there is no need of any written communication. This is all filler. And it cannot be considered. Now it says it will lead to a situation of confusion. How can there be confusion if that one person is not there? Your company cannot be reliable, rely only on one person. Okay, so obviously the C option is not right. So the correct option over there is B. And already given you a general knowledge in the beginning only. Right. Yes, coming to the next one, 9. DSP Company Chartered Accountants have been appointed as the statutory auditor of Flakes Private Limited for 16-17. The company's net profit has declined by 5% as compared to the previous year in spite of increase in sales. On verification of the company's profit and loss account, it is noticed that in the current year a huge amount is debited as loss on sale of fixed assets, due to which the profits has reduced. Right, so though the sales have increased, lot of loss on sale of fixed assets has, because of which the profits have gone down. The auditor discussed the matter with the management and was told that since the lot of fixed assets were lying idle due to their non-working condition, they have been sold at less than their written down value. And a going concern comes to your mind. As an auditor, do you think that the fact regarding the disposal of assets should be described in the auditor's report or in the notes to account? Right. If the assets have been sold as per company policy and AFRF, then no separate disclosure is required in the audit report or notes to accounts. As the sale of fixed assets has an impact on the profit for the current year, it should be disclosed in the notes to accounts. Even if the assets have been sold as per company policy and AFRF, right? So even if the assets have been sold as per company policy and AFRF, the auditor should disclose the fact in the emphasis of matter paragraph of the audit report, as the loss booked in the profit and loss account has a material impact on the net profit of the company. As the loss on sale of fixed assets is debited in P&L as per accounting standard, there is no requirement of disclosure of the same in any report. Right, see, we have to mainly give a justification that in spite of increase in sales, why the profits of the company has reduced. Right, so as an auditor, we would like to highlight this matter in our audit report by way of an emphasis of matter paragraph. Right, by way of an emphasis of matter paragraph. Right, so if it is as per AFRF, no disclosure required, not right. As the sale has an impact, it should be disclosed only in the notes, not right. There is no requirement of the disclosure in the same, not right. Okay, right. The auditor is required to evaluate, next question, management's judgment of the entity's ability to continue as a going concern. Certain events and conditions were identified that may cast a significant doubt on the company's ability to continue as a going concern. But based on the evidence obtained, the auditor concludes that no material uncertainty exists and no disclosures are explicitly required by the AFRF regarding these circumstances. If management's assessment of the entity's ability to continue as a going concern covers less than 12 months from the date of financial statements, the auditor is required to request management to extend its assessment period to at least 12 months from that date. Why at least 12 months? Because of the concept of foreseeable future, right? So that the entity is continuing its operations for a period of not less than 1 year from the date of the balance sheet, right? Foreseeable future, that the company will be in existence, right? For a foreseeable future. And at what is foreseeable future? Generally a period not longer than 1 year after the date of the balance sheet, okay? The management of the company would provide the financial support letter extended by its parent company. In the given case, which one of the following option is correct? The auditor may obtain the financial support letter from the parent company for a period of 12 months from the year-end date, may obtain the letter from the parent company for a period of 12 months from the date of signing of the financial statements, for a period of 12 months or less, or for a period of 12 months or less from the date of signing of the financial statements. I told you foreseeable future, 12 months from the date of the balance sheet, right? So from the year-end date, and then they've just created the other options, right? So that completes only 10 MCQs. So can you imagine the volume of time which is going to be required, right? The amount of time to read the big case study and to read the four options and delete the wrong one and hopefully select the correct one. Okay. Right, question number 11. Auditor's report on prior period, that is 2017, included a modified opinion on an unresolved matter. Auditor's report on prior period included a modified opinion on an unresolved matter. Right, so we are talking about SA710. Last year there was a misstatement. Was it reported last year? Yes. Has it been resolved? No. Last year there was a misstatement. Has it been reported last year? Yes. Has it been resolved? No. So what do? You modify the current opinion. That is what we know as per the standard. Right. You don't know that as per the standard. Go and see the chart of SA710. Right. If such a matter is not relevant, immaterial to the current period figures in the financial statements for 2018, how should the auditor deal with this matter in his audit report for 2018? So 2017, there was a qualification. Has the matter been resolved? No. Right. Since the matter is not relevant, no reporting in respect of this matter is required. Modify opinion on the current financial statements because of the effect or the possible effect of the unresolved matter on the comparability of the current and the corresponding figure. Considering the matter is not relevant material to the current period, the management may include a note in the financial statements, and basis that no reporting in respect of this matter would be required in the audit report. Include an emphasis of matter paragraph because of the effect or the possible effect of the unresolved matter on the comparability of the current period and the corresponding figures in the audit report for 2018. Right, see, had the matter been resolved, no reporting would have been required in the current year for the modification in the previous year report. But because the matter has not been resolved, we need to modify the current opinion. Right, so no reporting, not right. Included in the notes, not right. Included in the emphasis of matter paragraph, not right. What is right? You have to modify the current opinion. Is that clear to everyone? Right, coming to question number 12. DEF Limited has outsourced its payroll to a third party service organization. So that is SA 402. What should be the basis followed by the auditor of DEF Limited in respect of audit of payroll? The auditor should obtain a type 2 report as audit evidence to support his understanding of about the design and implementation of controls. Type 2 report would also serve as an evidence about the operating effectiveness of those controls. The auditor may refer to the work of the service auditor in his report containing an unmodified opinion and diminish his responsibility, no question only. Because whenever we use the work of others, we say continues to be responsible, does not diminish, right? Sole responsibility. The auditor should obtain a type 1 or a type 2 report as audit evidence to support his understanding of the, about the design and implementation of controls at the service organization. Type 2 report would also serve as audit evidence about the operating effectiveness of those controls. Since the payroll process is outsourced to a service organization, there is nothing much an auditor can do. No, you're wrong. Auditor should audit the other information for the financial statements and accordingly issue his opinion. Right, so now A and C. Auditor should obtain type 2 report. Auditor should obtain a type 1 or a type 2 report. So obviously it is type 1 or a type 2 report, yes, as when it is, as which is available. Right, coming to question number 13. The profits of XYZ Limited was rupees 1000 crore for the financial year 2018. While planning the audit, the auditor determined the materiality of rupees 50 crore. The materiality was taken as 5% of the profits of XYZ Limited. During the course of an audit, on becoming aware of information during the audit, audit adjustments were passed, resulting in significant decline in the profits of XYZ Limited. Post-audit adjustments, the profits reduced to rupees 500 crore. So earlier the profits were 1000 crore, 5%, materiality was 50 crore. Right, materiality was 50 crore. Right, and now post-audit adjustments, the profits reduced to 500 crore. Because of the change in the profits of the company, the materiality may get reduced to 25 crore. So now 5% of 500 crore, so materiality could be 25 crore. XYZ Limited is a large size company having a turnover of 20,000 crore for the financial year 18. Considering the size of the company, the auditor believes that materiality amount should not go below rupees 50 crore as that would result in a significant increase in their work and the work of the auditor may not get completed within the required timeline. Accordingly, the auditor wants to change the basis of materiality by increasing the percentage of profits or by taking revenue as the basis for computation of the materiality. In the given situation, which one of the following option is correct? Right, so now earlier materiality was computed as 50 crore. So any misstatement below 50 crore you are going to ignore. And obviously your sample size will be lesser as compared to when you take materiality 25 crore. And now if you reduce it to 25 crore, now you'll have to consider misstatements above 25 crore because up to 25 crore only you will be able to consider it to be an immaterial misstatement. Right. Considering the size of the company, the auditor may be appropriate in changing the basis of materiality to save his work. No, not to save work. The basis of materiality cannot be changed to save the increased work of the auditor if there has been additional information which resulted in decline of profits during the audit. The auditor need not change the materiality basis. He can complete his audit using the materiality which was determined initially by him by planning the audit. No, we revise the materiality as the audit progresses. New information, additional information, change in auditor's understanding, change in circumstances, SA 320. Right, so save work, no. Should not revise materiality, no. Since the profits have got reduced due to the audit adjustment, the same cannot be considered to be the basis for computation of materiality. Materiality has to be based on management computed numbers. No. Right, it cannot be based. See, you have to take an estimate in the beginning, right? It were on the basis of what was calculated, determined initially by the auditor, and information which he had initially with him, right? So the correct answer over here would be B. Just because to say can the basis of materiality cannot be changed to save the increased work of the auditor. So you need not do any other analysis. You have to think only from the viewpoint of the four options which have been given in the question. Everybody, are you still with me? Are you seeing? Yes, which MCQ have we reached up to so far? 13, so just 7 more to go. Okay, right. APC and Company LLP has been appointed as the statutory auditor of WEF Limited. Previous auditor of WEF Limited was MLMN and Company LLP. Right, so now who is appointed? ABC, previous auditor LMN. For the purpose of accepting the position as the statutory auditor, ABC and Company LLP has sent a written communication to LMN and Company to obtain a no objection letter. Right? Incoming auditor has sent a request for NOC to the outgoing auditor, 811, clause 8, part 1, first schedule. In the given case, which one of the following option is correct? Rather, I tell you that incoming auditor, he has to check for three things. One, he has to obtain an NOC from the outgoing auditor. If he does not get an NOC from the outgoing auditor, guilty of professional misconduct under 811. Second, incoming auditor, you need to check whether the undisputed audit fees of the previous auditor have been paid. Yes, this provision does not apply to a sick unit, where the net worth is negative. If not, then again 1-2-2, because it is given by way of a notification. And third, incoming auditor, you need to check whether the company has complied with the provisions of section 139 to section 142 of the Companies Act. If not, guilty of professional misconduct under 911. Right. In the given case, which of the following options is correct? ABC and Company LLP needs to ensure that the appointment is made by DEF as per the provisions of Companies Act. Need not communicate with the previous auditor. Immediately wrong. ABC and Company needs to make a communication and obtain no objection for accepting the position as statutory auditor. Once this is done, ABC can be appointed as an auditor. In that case, it will not be mandatory to follow the provision. Out. ABC and Company LLP needs to ensure that the appointment is made as per the provisions of Companies Act. Also needs to make a communication to obtain his no objection letter. Right. And the last one needs to ensure that his appointment is as per the provision. Once that is done, no need to communicate, right? So again, that is wrong. Right, so you know, always before reading the four options, you think of some general content relating to the question that you know about. Okay, before you read the answers. Why? Because once you've read the four answers, then already your mind has been, what do you say, some content has already been put into your mind. So any original thinking or any thoughts before looking at the options will not come. Okay, right. Next one. Question number 15. The auditor is required to audit a complete set of annual financial statements for 2018 prepared under Ind AS by the management solely for the preparation of consolidated financial statements of the holding company. So why financial statements have been prepared as per Ind AS solely? For the preparation of the consolidated financial statements of the holding company. Is the auditor required to include other legal and regulatory requirements, 143 subsection 3, to comment on matters such as maintenance of proper books of account, compliance with accounting standards in the audit report? Is 143.3 reporting required to be done for consolidated financial statements? Is 143.3 reporting required to be done for consolidated financial statements? No, it is not required. And now this company is preparing financial statements as per Ind AS solely for the purpose of the consolidation of the holding company. Since the auditor is required to audit the complete set of financial statements, it will be mandatory for the auditor to include other legal regulatory requirements. the audit report is not issued pursuant to requirement of section 143, and hence other legal reporting requirements is not required to be included in the audit report. The audit report is not issued pursuant to requirement of section 143, and hence some of the requirements relating to other legal regulatory requirements may be included in the audit report as per the discretion of the management. This so immediately I'll tick off. Right, out. The auditor may include other legal regulatory requirement in the audit report, but he would need approval of the board of directors. Out. Right, so what does it say? Since the auditor is required to audit complete set of financial statements under Ind AS, it will be mandatory. No. Right, and the audit report is not issued pursuant to section 143. It has been prepared solely for the purpose of consolidated financial statements of the holding company. That is why B is not required to include these matters in his audit report. Right, that is 15. Coming to 16. A Limited is a company in the business of buying and selling modern and contemporary Indian arts. Following are the assets in millions of the company on 31st March 2017. Fixed assets 10 million, investment 20 million, loans and advances 40 million, inventories 400 million, trade receivable 10 million, cash and cash equivalents 20 million. Right, so only inventories is 400 million, 3 digit, all others are 2 digit, 10, 20, 40, 10, 20. The management has not obtained valuation of inventory as at 31st March 2017 from a valuation expert in art form, has not obtained valuation of inventory. The auditor could not perform alternative procedures for valuation of inventory. Right, so unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence. Is it material and pervasive? Looks like. Why? Because 400 crore. Right, you know SA 705. What is this? Not able to obtain the report of the expert and also not able to perform alternative procedures. Therefore, auditors were not able to comment on the carrying value of inventory. However, the auditors were able to obtain sufficient appropriate evidence in respect of all other captions of the financial statements. The auditors qualified their opinion in the audit report. What are your views on the auditors qualifying their report? Right, the auditors were able to obtain evidence for the other captions, so the auditor may qualify their opinion considering only one caption could be misstated. Total assets amount to 500, out of which 400 is inventory, 80%. This signifies that inventories are not, that auditors are not able to obtain evidence on 80% of the assets. Hence, possible misstatement, if any, could be pervasive. Therefore, the auditor should issue adverse opinion. Unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence, material and pervasive. Obviously, it is going to be disclaimer of opinion, right? Third option. Same thing, everything same. Only therefore the auditors should issue a disclaimer of opinion. And inventory is considered to be an important component. This is one of the items wherein significant risk may exist. Auditors should take cognizance of this fact and accordingly decide qualified adverse or disclaimer. No, no, we know audit report very properly. So we can directly, clearly tell you that it has to be disclaimer of opinion. Right, unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence, material and pervasive. Right, disclaimer of opinion. Right, next one, 17. XYZ Limited is in the business of trading of industrial equipments. The company's operations are based out of India and Germany. For the purpose of hedge, the company has taken forward contracts. The company is phase one company as per the requirements of Ind AS, and hence forward contracts have been fair valued for the purpose of preparation of financial statements. The company also got its property, plant and equipment fair valued. Right. The company has shown its fair valuation reports in respect of the above items to the auditor. What should be the responsibilities of the auditor in this case? So what all did they get fair valued? Forward contracts and also the property, plant and equipment. Phase 1 for the requirement of Ind AS. The auditor may refer to the work of the valuer in his report containing an unmodified opinion and accordingly reduce his responsibility. Out. No responsibility reduced. The auditor may refer to the work of the valuer in respect of forward contract, but not for property, plant and equipment containing an unmodified opinion and accordingly reduce his responsibility. Out. The auditor may refer to the work of the valuer in his report for property, plant and equipment, but not for forward contract containing an unmodified opinion, and accordingly reduce his responsibility for the audit opinion. No reducing responsibility, right? Sole responsibility. The auditor may involve his own expert for the purpose of audit of fair valuation of the forward contracts and property, plant and equipment. But in any case, he cannot reduce his responsibility. Now I feel better reading this sentence. He cannot reduce his responsibility for the audit opinion by referring to the work of the valuer in his report. Perfect. Right? 18. Right? Three more. Right, PQR Limited has 3 subsidiaries, 2 associates, 5 joint ventures. The standalone and consolidated of PQR are audited by Jain and Company LLP, group auditors for statutory reporting in India. The standalone financial statements of other group companies of PQR are audited by some other audit firm, which are referred to as the component auditors. For the purpose of consolidation, the instructions sent by Jain and Company LLP to component auditors state that the principal auditors would be working on the principle of division of responsibility. Right? So parent company auditor different, component auditors different. Right? State that the principal auditors would be working on the principle of division of responsibility. The instructions further state that the group auditor may review selected working papers of the component auditor covering identified areas of emphasis if required. Right? So the working papers of the branch auditor, component auditor, they may at their discretion make available to the parent company auditor. Considering the local requirements, the component auditors do not agree to get their working papers reviewed from the group auditors. Right? Because I told you it is at their discretion. Right? They have no obligation, the component auditors, to provide access to their working papers to the principal auditor. Please choose the course of action for the group auditors in the given case. Right? We put a para in our audit report that out of the above, yes, how many subsidiaries? Just say 2-3 subsidiaries, 2 associates, 5 joint ventures have been audited by an auditor other than the company auditor, the parent company auditor, and we've been furnished with the reports of the component auditors. Right. PQR Limited. So what are the options? As per the SA, when the principal auditor has to base his opinion on the financial statement information of an entity as a whole, relying upon the statements and reports of the other auditor, his reports would be stating the division of responsibility for the financial information of the entity by indicating the extent to which the financial statements of the components have been audited, reviewed by the component auditor, having been included in the financial information of the entity. When you read all this, your case study writing practice also happens simultaneously. Right. The group auditor is not required to audit the financial statements of the component. Okay. For the purpose of consolidation, the group auditor would have to issue his opinion on the consolidated, which would comprise the financial statements of the component, and hence the group auditor is required to audit the financial statements of the component out. For the purpose of consolidation, the group auditor would have to issue his report on the consolidated, which would comprise the financial statements of the component. Hence, the group auditor may either audit the financial statements of the component or review the work of component auditor out. No reviewing. It's their responsibility. For the purpose of consolidation, the group auditor would have to issue his opinion on the consolidated, which would comprise the financial statements of the component. Hence, the group auditor would be required to review the work of the component auditor. If the component auditor do not provide access to their working papers to the group auditor may qualify out. If they don't provide access to working paper, you will qualify. No. So, A is the correct answer. Okay. 19. ABC and Company LLP have been appointed as the statutory auditor of WEF Limited. Previous auditor of WEF Limited was MS LMN and Company LLP. WEF Limited is a subsidiary of WEF Holding Company UK. For the purpose of consolidation, WEF Limited is required to send the financial information of the company for the year in the reporting package comprising of the balance sheet, profit and loss, cash flow and the notes. Since WEF Holding Limited has many group companies across the globe to ensure consistency in reporting of numbers under various heads, a standard reporting package is used by all the group companies. And having different accounting framework, then they have a group accounting manual. The group companies do not have any provision to change the grouping classification, which needs to be reported as per the group accounting manual, which is prepared as per the group accounting policies. Group follows IFRS. ABC and Company LLP is also required to audit the reporting package of WEF Limited as per IFRS. During the course of audit, the auditor observed that some classifications are not in line with IFRS. Why not in line with IFRS? Because they are as per the group accounting policies. Right? Group, the policy may be something different. However, due to the limitation of the reporting package, no such corrections can be made. How should the auditor deal with this? So, to comply with the requirement of the group, they have not been able to comply with the requirements of the IFRS. Since all the classifications are in line with the requirements of the group as per the reporting package, the auditor did not change anything and should issue a clean report. Since all the classifications are in line with the requirements of the group as per the reporting package, the auditor did not change anything and should issue a clean report. However, the auditor may include a note separately in respect of the correction. Since all the classifications are in line with the requirement of the group, as per the group reporting package, the auditor cannot change anything. However, the auditor is required to issue a report as per IFRS wherein the classifications are wrong, and hence the auditor should issue qualified report if the amount is material. Since all the classifications are in line with the requirements of the group as per the reporting package, the auditor need not change anything. Oh my God, four same sentence again. However, the auditor should issue his report as per the group accounting manual instead of IFRS. No. Right, you issue the report as per group accounting manual? No. Right, the auditor need not change anything and issue a qualified clean report? No. Right, the auditor may include a separate note in respect of the corrections required? No. Right, the auditor is required to issue a report as per IFRS and wherein the classifications are wrong, and the auditor should issue a qualified report. Right, so your group accounting also is done. You've prepared financial statements for consolidation, which can be used for consolidation. But at the same time, you've mentioned in those financial statements wherever IFRS has not been complied. Okay, right. AKB Limited is a large size company having diversified business activities. The company's operations are spread across various locations within India and outside India. The company has many units and plants. The number of transactions of the company is large and it uses SAP as its ERP package. The company appointed LLM and Associates as their new tax auditors for the current year. Tax auditors were reviewing the statutory compliances and observed currently there is no process of the company to check whether TDS has been correctly deducted on all transactions or not. Since the transactions of the company may be running in thousands and covers various provisions of TDS, the management believes that such a process cannot be established. Also, in the past, this experience was never done, and no case of any short non-deduction of TDS has been reported in Form 3CD in the past. Right? How should the tax auditor deal with this matter in his report? Management is right, and hence it should be ignored by the tax auditor. Obviously not. TDS, TCS is a big matter of concern for the tax auditor. Tax auditor should test check and basis that he should close this point. No. Management should provide a reconciliation to the auditor regarding the reconciling the accruals expenses with TDS deducted during the year to ensure TDS is deducted appropriately. If the same is not available, tax auditor should qualify his report. Okay, right, seems to be right. They should ask for the reconciliation. If not, tax auditor should qualify. Management should set up a process as per the requirement of the tax auditor. For the current year, tax auditor should obtain management representation on this matter and should close. No, close to no only. Right, so the correct answer is C. Right, so we've just completed one set of MCQs issued by ICAI. Right, go through this again and again, you know, so that you get the hang, right, so that the concepts get into your mind. Yes, very, you are clear about the concepts. Right, thank you so much.